Welcome everyone to Cyber Week 2022. It's the 21st anniversary of ODR Cyber Week for the National Center for Technology and Dispute Resolution, and we're very glad you're joining us, whether it's live or later in watching this recording. We're lucky today to have an expert on AI and ODR, and I will hand the mic over shortly to our wonderful ODR expert host, who will introduce him. But first, let me just share a little bit about what this week is going to be like. We're on the second day of a pack-filled week, and I'm going to go over briefly a little bit about a series that we're offering in particular this year, and that's on ODR Beyond Monetary Disputes. Yesterday, we had a presentation on ODR and healthcare, and today we'll have one on ODR and Canadian immigration and refugee cases. And there are several others for the rest of the week, one a day on digital privacy, labor arbitration, and public dispute resolution post-COVID. We hope you'll join us for those. And today, we're fortunate to have a presentation on algorithm to assess possibility of resolution with Professor Anu Lee and our host, Morenike Obi-Farinde. And now I turn it over to Morenike.
Thank you very much, Lee, for the kind introductions, and welcome everybody to this session. We have in our midst Professor Anu Lee, who is the president of the Beijing E-Bridge China Research Institute. He's visiting professor at Qinghua University, Beijing, China, and adjunct professor at East West Center, Honolulu, Hawaii. Before this position, Professor Lee was a professor at the University of International Business and Economy in Beijing, China, since 2010. Professor Lee served as the chief scientist of the university's e-commerce research institute and headed the university's Shenghe Research Institute, which is a thinking tank founded jointly by the university and Shenghe municipal government. Prior to the university position, Professor Lee was the director of e-commerce technology research center at China Academy of Sciences for 10 years. Before coming back to China, Professor Lee worked in Silicon Valley for over 12 years as an engineer and research scientist in various companies, including LSI Logic, Silicon Graphic, HP Lab. Professor Lee founded Internet Image Incorporated in 1997 and successfully merged with Intraware, a NASDAQ-listed company. Professor Lee was educated in Shanghai Jia Tong University, University of Arizona, and the Stanford University with HP Corporate Fellowship. Without much ado, let's welcome Professor Lee for his presentation on algorithm to assess possibility of resolution. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Monica. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Ethan. It's a long time no see. And let me get my screen. And today I'd like to present my recent work on the algorithm to assess possibility of resolution. And again, I'd like to, first of all, apologize that I am very much an engineer to talk about all those legal issues and a lot of terms and a lot of wording may not necessarily precise and particularly to the to all your expert in the ODR domain. And the key concept I like to introduce in this recent work in the algorithm to access the possibility of resolution are, one, we introduce a satisfaction index. And this satisfaction index, and sorry, this is kind of like a translate from Chinese, means like the party in dispute, how satisfied to a given resolution. And then there is a resolution satisfaction index. That means this a comprehensive measure of the how possible this resolution can resolve this dispute. So one, the party satisfaction index means how happy this particular party in dispute to this resolution. And the resolution satisfaction index means this whole thing, this resolution, how happy, how possible this resolution can be used as the final resolution to resolve this dispute. Then we have dynamic polling and evaluation. That means for every resolution we proposed, and we do a dynamic polling to find out what is the satisfaction index. And during this dynamic polling, we dynamically adjust the weight of each survey, like, because we're going to pull in many people, many participants, and how important their opinion, how important their evaluation of satisfaction are controlled by this weight. This is a weight. So we're gonna change this weight to reflect the opinion leader to every resolution. And the polling and the evaluation are all done online and can be done also offline. Now we introduce a very important concept called the box of settlement. We need to make sure all those quantitative evaluation of satisfaction has to be fall in this box. This box, I will later on show you what this box is. And in this box, we can demonstrate the trend of how this resolution is approaching the final resolution, or how this is going to become more and more possible or less and less possible to resolve this dispute. Then we have another term called a structured resolution. And we heard a smart resolution that is tied to the implementation. But this structured resolution is basically tied to the iteration of the resolution. That means when we do every when the party or mediator make any resolution, they are connected to the past resolution and also connected with each other. So every change, they were automatically showing the possibility of this resolution to the other parties. And then there is an AI guided exit strategy. For the resolution, we are looking for two things. One is to reach the final resolution of the dispute, or to look for the exit of the mediation. So we don't have to waste time anymore. We just exit, go to the legal process or some attribution process. So the exit is very important. That exit is to basically control how this process, because in many of the cases we deal with, we found the time spent dispute resolution are sometimes even more important than the results. So we need to finish this ASAP. And so from a different view, we're going to category the dispute. I mean, like in China, we basically always say this dispute is either the party either looking for mandatory or financial reward, or looking for some superficial penalty or some kind of like damage to the other party, not really financially. And for the lawyer, they can category in more logical way, like a family, commercial, industry, property. But as an engineer, we category the dispute as one quantitative. That means everything is number. We can by changing the number, we can make both sides accept or reject the dispute. Or quantitative, that means this thing is not by number, it's by some sort of principle. And then emotional, that means this thing is not really by principle, it's more by the feeling, the people's feeling. So that's change. If for a set of circumstances, the emotion will change. Then there is an ideological, that means by some sort of religion guided belief. So we just feel those are the, this for engineer, I mean, we either use data to change in sense or we use some sort of principle to change in sense. And this particular research I'm currently working on is focused on the first one, that is the quantitative dispute. So for the ODR in an engineer view, in the first category of the dispute, that means everything can be assigned a value or can be described in the quantitative way. So in that situation, the online dispute resolution will become a maximize the satisfaction for both parties in dispute. So that means as long as both sides are happy, we're looking for the maximum value. So that is all we can do in ODR. I mean, we cannot do beyond that because that's the maximum value. And another thing is we need to quantitize the claim. So we need to basically assign numbers to everything we both sides claim. So that means the reward and the cost of the claim. Reward cost of the time to implement those claims. The reward and cost of psychological impact and the reward and cost of relationship impact. So we have to really put everything at value. And this value can reflect what they demand. For example, they want some money, or they want a rent, or they want to something. Or it's they're feigning. For example, if they like to have apologized, so we have to assign a number for this apologize, the sincerity or the extent of the apologize. So we need to assign numbers for everything, or they need to pay in one time or paid in different installments. So those things we need to assign a number to reflect those claims. And then we need to consistently survey to evaluate the satisfaction of both parties and generate a value to represent the satisfaction of the parties in the dispute. Then we're looking for the maximum value. And we want to guarantee the value is going upwards. And as long as we start to feel the value is going downwards, that means we are reaching the maximize, the maximum value. So, and also we changing the algorithm based on the circumstance. We have to change the algorithm is more towards certain logic so that we can evaluate the satisfaction index. And what are the rules? And how we measure this rule. So the rule in our view are parties in dispute. So the people who are in dispute. So they need to tell us their willingness to accept certain resolution or their determination to refuse certain resolution or their uncertainty. So they may be in doubt, so their uncertainty. And for the mediator, we need to measure their experience, and we need to measure their opinion on the legality of this resolution. We cannot have the resolution are totally illegal, and we need to also to measure the feasibility of a resolution from the mediator point of view. Then we introduce another crowd called the invited observers. So the invited observers is the people who invited by the parties to help them evaluate the solution. So from these people, we are looking for the emotion, their emotional measurement. So how supportive they are to the party. And also their rational, whether this resolution is rational enough for them, and also the legality. So they think this resolution are legal or not. And for the demand and the compromise, for every party, we always look for their demand. What's their demand? And what they can compromise. For the demand, we need to list all their demand. And for every demand, we need to assign a value to this demand. And the demand, we also divide it into the demand that are negotiable or the demand are not negotiable. And also for the demand, we need to list the method to implement, how this demand to be implemented. And again, every method, we assign a quantitative variable to this method. So this method of, to implement, we also divide it into timely. This implementation is limited in a given time, or it's not timely. So those are the way we describe the demand in a quantitative way. For compromise, we do the same thing. And we list all the compromise. Then we do a conditional. We need to know it's conditional or it's not conditional. And we also to the for the method to implement, we also need to know whether it's timely or it's not timely. So after we have the demand and the compromise, we start to construct the resolution index that to evaluate the intention to set. And then we have different algorithms. For example, we compare the demand of both parties. We analyze the demand list. We do the weight assignment. For the pooling of the satisfaction, that is when for every resolution, we will pool. We need to know how the every party to every participant their satisfaction to this resolution. So for the party in dispute, we currently offer two ways of fill the satisfaction survey. One is we can assign an AI agent to the party in dispute. So this AI agent can automatically complete the survey so that to reflect the party's satisfaction. Also, the party itself can finish the survey and reflect its satisfaction to this resolution. For the mediator, same thing. The mediator itself can do the same. And also we have a mediator agent who can do these things. But this agent has to be trained by the mediator with all the past cases. And also we have some rule to train the mediator. For the party, the AI is more based on the general public domain information. We train this AI. So that is not very human specific. But for the mediator agent, it's very mediator specific. For the observer, equal number of observers are invited by either party of the dispute. And also observer need to access to the mobile device and have knowledge of the dispute and the claim of each party. So for the observer, they have to fill online. They have to fill online.
Hello, Andy. We can't hear you.
Hello?
Hello, okay. Yeah, we can hear you now.
Okay. The dynamical weighting is for the party in dispute, we give them the full weight. That's one. For the mediator, the weight is originally decided by the party in dispute. So the party in dispute will decide the starting weight. Then we dynamically change. That's going to reflect how influential or how much trust the each party to the mediator. So the weight for mediator is more dynamic. For the observer, again, the initial value will be decided by the party. So we will ask the party, your uncle, how important do you think he is? Is he going to, from 0 to 10, I mean, if it's 2 or 3 or 4. So we will let the party to make the initial value of the party. And then we use AI to make the dynamic change. And how to make a dynamic change? Basically, we're going to compare the satisfaction level of the observer and the party. So we consistently compare the reaction of the observer to the reaction of the party to see how they are consistent or how they are relevant to decide what kind of weight to put on the observer. And then the server of the satisfaction, the party in dispute, and we do online server, and we limit it in 2 minutes to close. And for the mediator, the online server will be closed in 5 minutes. For the participant, the online server will also close in 5 minutes. So that means once we have a resolution, we send out to the parties. They have 2 minutes to close the server and fill in everything. For the mediator and the participant, we give them 5 minutes to finish. The server are very simple. We have calculated the server with the general knowledge of the dispute. They can finish within like 1 minute. The factor in the server. So what is the what we ask them? What kind of question we ask? We ask the those people, these participants, and we basically say for the ask the dispute party's opinion on the cost and the time to implement and the afterwards impact. For the opinions, for the mediator's opinion, we more ask for the legality and feasibility. For observer's opinion, we ask for their, basically their emotional choice and also their the rationality to see how rational the opinion, the solution is. Then we do the calculation of the satisfaction index. The party's total satisfaction index is calculated as the weighted addition of the individual satisfaction index, which we calculate after they finish the survey. And the satisfaction index of mediator and the satisfaction index of the observer. And the resolution satisfaction index is calculated as the weighted addition of the party's total satisfaction index and the SI of the, all the mediators and the satisfaction index of all the observers. So basically the party's satisfaction index is based on his own survey and also the weighted survey results of the mediator and the observer. And the resolution index, satisfaction index is based on everybody's satisfaction index with a different weight distribution. The box of satisfaction. We first of all have a default box. The default box, we have four extreme resolution to define the default box. That means the X, Y means the party's satisfaction index. So you have X side, Y side. And the Z represent the resolution for the satisfaction index. So we have immediately have 4 points. One is all zero, the original, and then the one party is 100% satisfied. The other party is zero satisfied. One party is, another party is 100% satisfied. The other are zero. Then we have everybody happy. So those are the original points. So the box will consist, let me show you the box. So this is the box. So we got these 4 points. That means A is all happy, and the B is not happy at all. And this is the B all happy, and the A is not happy at all. Now we have a success point. That means everybody is happy. So we have got these 4 phases, phase one, phase two, phase three, and phase four. So, then that's the default box. So for the default box, we got all these borders, area, volume, and the center point. Then we have a starting box. For starting box, we need to, first of all, we need to create 2 data points. So we want each party offer 1 resolution so that we can generate 2 data points. So just like this, we need this possibly offered by A, because he is more happy than B. So this is I, the solution offered by A. And this could be the solution offered by B. So we got these 2 points. So this will be our starting box. And we call it a starting box. So starting box, we got the 2 additional points. So that generate not rectangular, not rectangular box. It's become a different box. So this is our, when we're gonna start our resolution iteration. So after we have an initial box, then we start to iteration all the resolution. And for the resolution, every resolution, if we fit outside of the box, then depends on its total, the resolution index. If the resolution index is higher, it's higher, it's in the uptrend, then we're going to make that point as an additional point of the box. We're going to change it just like this. Let me show you. If we found a point outside of the box, here outside of the box, then we're going to move the, we're going to generate 2 additional resolution by moving this point vertically up or horizontally, like go this way, until it's touch the border. So these are the 2 resolution we are working towards. And if it's if the resolution is fall inside the box, then we're going to inside the box, then we're going to make a straight line and choose with a 0.618 position to have another resolution and to see how it's going to basically go in towards the success exit point. So this is how we're going to basically use the box to help our resolution iteration. And for the when we're going to stop from a box point of view is when the box area is greater than 70% of the default box, then we're going to stop. That means this whole ODR process is will not have any results. When the volume is less than 30% of the default box, then we also call exit. So for these 2 situation, we're going to exit with no any resolution. Then we're going to introduce a structured resolution. And the structured resolution is basically a smart resolution and with a dynamic resolution index projection by AI. So that means for this resolution, and we have we immediately, once the party A or party B work on the resolution, they will immediately give a dynamic value of a possible projected resolution index. That means how close this resolution towards the resolve this dispute. So this one is a projection, is going to be calculated by AI based on the past iteration and the best reaction of the other party, and try to fit the point inside the box. So this will give a number. So that means the people, the party who work on the resolution will immediately know the whether this resolution is going upwards towards the success exit. And also for the demand, we have a set of the adjustable variable. Then it's dynamically adjust the variable of all the demands. So that the way how we're going to work on the resolution is by change adjust those variables. And the same thing is develop the resolution is by dynamically adjust the variable that assigned to the compromise. So that's the smart resolution part. The structural resolution part is we dynamically gave the number of resolution index, as I said in the smart set. Another thing is that the all those variable chains have a range, which is decided by coordinate everything, make sure all the final data point is fall into the box. And also the everything is connected to each party. So this is how we do the structured resolution. And the resolution iteration, first of all, the resolution can be created by party or AI. So that means, well, I already show you when the resolution point fell inside of the box, how we're going to move the next resolution. If we fail outside of the box, how we move it. So this resolution is created, then it's a pooling. Then we're going to calculate the satisfaction value. Then we're going to check whether this results fit into the box. Yes, if it's fitting the box, then we're going to just move towards the success point. No, if the resolution is the box, is the resolution index, if it's upwards, that means it's going up, then we're going to redraw the box. If the resolution box is downwards, then we're going to create two resolutions, as we said, we're going to vertically move towards the edge of the border of the box, or horizontally move to the border of the box. Algorithm iteration. Basically, we're going to dynamically adjust the variable and the demand and the compromise assignment. We're going to check changing the variable so that we changing the algorithm. We're going to dynamically changing the weight to assess the influence of the decision making of the all participants. And based on the location inside of the box, we choose a different algorithm. And we're going to delete incapable and non-influential participant. So that means that we're going to dynamically adjust the participants. So that's how we change the algorithm, by changing the participant, by changing the algorithm choice, and by changing the weight and by changing the variable. And exit, for the exit, we have two exit strategy. One is if the resolution points are all fall into phase three. Phase three, let me show you phase three. Phase three is phase three. And if all the resolution is in this area, then our goal is to have a quick exit of a failing resolution. And if all the resolution in the phase two in this area, then we try to push for a success exit of the resolution. So so that's how we do the so once we found the maximum resolution with the maximum resolution satisfaction index, we just gave this resolution to the two parties to say either take it, you both accept, then we that's it, or if either one reject, then this whole thing failed. So same thing for the it's in phase two. So that's how we, because we are looking for a quick exit. So the implementation of this whole system is one is a dispute process unit. And we have a dispute process that's basically to take the dispute and have the case management, record keeping, and for the and also mediator selection and the observer invitation, and also function for administrative work, so that we want to make sure that the participants are well aware of this dispute and will be able to participate with the polling. So that is basically the dispute process unit, is to understand these cases and be able to participate in the dispute. And so that's the unit, that's one unit. And then the pooling and the survey unit. The pooling and survey unit is basically to achieve the dynamic survey. And so we need a consistent, for every resolution iteration, we need to survey and calculate the satisfaction index so that we can know where the point fall in which will fall in the box. And so the pooling and the survey units is basically where we keep the resolution iterate. And the smart resolution units basically is to help the party generate the resolution and also to decide when to exit this whole process. So those are the examples. And I think the time is running out with my Zoom. And those are the example of how those box is generate and how it's resolution iteration and how they finally we're going to find the maximum resolution index and the exit. Then there is a case, we have been using this algorithm in many landlord talent and the family dispute and some level of contract dispute, very comprehensively used in those, we call the more financial dispute. And currently we are in Chengdu, we did a pilot for past 2 years because of the pandemic has so many those disputes. And we had very good, recently we achieved almost 100% for success in the dispute resolution. And so I want to leave some time for the question and the discussion.
Thank you, Andy.
Okay.
For the presentation. And we will open the floor now for questions. And from the layman's understanding, I think what the resolution algorithm seeks to show us is when mediation is no more effective, when it's no more cost effective, and when we should exit. That's the essence of the algorithm.
Yes.
Thank you very much. So do we have any questions?
Well, I have a question. Yes. Go ahead, Leah.
Go ahead, Ethan. Hi, Ethan.
So I'm sorry, Andy, I got called away right at the beginning of this and missed about 5 minutes. But exactly when would you use this?
Oh,
at what stage, at what part of the process? Before the process starts, after it starts?
We use this is at the initial submission of a dispute. Now in China, for example, for the landlord-tenant dispute, now in China, there is a government agency that is supervising all the rent and the commercial lease and all those. In that department, they have a dispute center. So whenever the we have this units, we have this this dispute process unit kind of embedded in their web page. So whenever there is a landlord and a tenant dispute, they just go in there, they set up their account, then this thing is going to kick in. So they're going to start to resolve that. This agent has no any relation with the court or even with the mediation center. It's basically belongs to the administrative side of the government.
Now, the reason I ask is that the title of the presentation is Algorithm to Assess the Possibility of Resolution. Mm-hmm. it might be a little, might be able to express this a little more clearly, possibility of resolution at what point?
Okay, so what are we, the algorithm is basically, is based on this one. We have this algorithm consists of five major components. One is we come up with a satisfaction index that we ask everybody, are you happy with this resolution? We use a quantitative system to represent their satisfaction to the resolution, and there are some formulas to calculate that, and then we come up with a resolution satisfaction index. That means how part the probability. Just exactly as the title, the probability of the resolution. So the resolution satisfaction index is actually indicate how probable we can resolve this dispute into a resolution. So that is the index. Another one to get this number, to get the final number, to get the final the maximum. The resolution with the maximum satisfaction index, we introduce dynamic pooling, we introduce a box of settlement, and we introduce a structured resolution, and finally we have an exit. Like when we claim we have a resolution, we have a best resolution we can get to for this dispute. So here the most critical mathematical intensive units is the box of resolution. That is where we construct a box that to monitor, construct this kind of box to see this A is a party A, his satisfaction index. B is the party B satisfaction index. The Z, I didn't show, Z is the total, the resolution satisfaction index. So we constructing this one, we found that as long as we are moving inside this box, and moving towards upper, this success point is where we get the best resolution. Exit point is where we will not have any resolution that both sides can accept. So basically we're working in this box to generate resolution after resolution to see how those data points fill in.
You still there, Andy?
Yeah, I'm still here.
And just one last question. The dynamic part of this, could you go back to the
dynamic part of the, we call the resolution iteration.
There was a different screen which had dynamic as part of the screen.
Oh.
I think dynamic there were four,
weighting.
Dynamic weighting, right.
Dynamic weighting is means when we do the iteration, when we do resolution iteration, the in the algorithm, in the formula, there are many weights. For example, like if I invite my uncle to be an observer, and how much his satisfaction index will add to the final satisfaction index of the resolution, that coefficient is called a weight, and we change that weight based on what we observe how coordinate, how consistent is the uncle to this party's reaction to the resolution.
Okay, thanks, Andy. This was magnificent.
Thank you very much.
I think Leah has her hand up, and then we have a question in the chat box we will take after you, Leah. Go on.
Thank you, Andy. Really, really interesting, innovative and creative. I have a question which I wonder if it's connected to culture. I'm not sure, but I'm absolutely intrigued that you have included observers and mediators in the value of an outcome. So coming from an extremely individualistic culture, which I think the West in general is, but certainly in the United States is, even embedded in the the codes for mediator intervention, just for example, and responsibilities of mediators, is to focus on the self-empowerment of the individual. And so I was thinking about how, first of all, the idea of asking parties to include observers as if what they think of the outcome should matter seems like something that's foreign to the way that mainstream, at least US mediation, focuses on individualism. Mm-hmm. And it only should matter what the individual parties think. That's one thing. The other thing is by inviting in the mediator or the third parties and what they think of the outcome, I'm assuming this is outcome, is also fascinating. From at least I'm looking at it from a cultural perspective, and I'm wondering whether you're asking the mediators what they think of the outcome or what they're thinking of the process. So are there views being weighted regarding outcome? That's one question. The other is, have you used this in a variety of cultural settings, or what is the specific cultural setting? If you could just share a little bit more about this, because I think it expands our international conversation with each other about who weighs in on what an outcome should be.
I think what we found that for the party in dispute, particularly in the case we deal with, a lot of them have a quite significant part of their thinking is uncertainty. They have a lot of uncertainty. I mean, they are very sure in something. They're very sure. They're like non-negotiable, or they have very clear demand. But at least over 30 to 40% of their demand are actually on either negotiable or uncertain. So for this uncertain stance, based on we did about 10,000 cases data mining, we found that the mediator and observer play a very important role to influence them. For something they are very sure, they don't really listen to other people. But for something they are not very sure, the other people's opinion are sometimes very influential. And we did see during the course, the observers' weight, that means their impact, are sometimes going down, sometimes going up, and those happens all the time. And for the mediator, their weight are very high at the beginning because people, they first of all, they trust the mediator, then they start to found the rhythm for negotiation or rhythm of talking, then they start to feel mediators are not that important. So their weight is going down. So there are some dynamical change of the weight. By we are basically, our system is looking for the happiness, the satisfaction of the people in dispute. And compare with the satisfaction of a mediator and the observer to see how consistent they are. But we have to look at the multiple data to see that. And then we found that we, including mediator and the observer, really gave some positive push for for this dispute to be resolved. And we tried with one observer, each party invite one observer, or invite two, invite three, to see how the final results. And we found that the results are very, the observer sometimes play very positive role in achieving resolution, the final resolution.
Yeah, thank you for explaining that. I think I think it would be fabulous to have further conversation about all of this, because it really gets to the heart of the myth of neutrality that certainly I think the US and much of the West sees as central. And so we argue it doesn't matter what the mediator thinks. We argue the goal is to keep the mediator's views out. And this is overtly saying the mediator has a role. And so many different cultures play that, mediation plays out in that way. But I think it plays out more often in the US and the West than we own. And so I just appreciate this is made quite evident and clear. And this has just been fascinating how you've incorporated algorithms in this. Thank you, Andy.
Sure, thank you.
Andy, just as a follow-on to what Leah has just said, when you say feasibility, what I assume, and this is for clarity, that you mean is the workability of the resolution, not necessarily that the mediator is deciding, and maybe you could clarify, do you mean that the mediator is taking a decision for the parties, or you mean the mediator is looking at the workability or the practicality of decisions that the parties are taking?
In this algorithm, mediator is pretty much less rule. It's more like a neutral. People who is not relevant with any party, they just evaluate the resolution, and in case the parties are not able to generate a resolution, they can generate some resolution, and so it's more like a co. The party is like a host. Mediator is more like a co-host. So it's
so the mediator just wants to ensure that what they decide will work.
Yeah, they gave some the participants in the polling, and they gave their they fill in their server. And the observer is not neutral. The observer usually is the party's relative, party's friends, the party's wife, whoever they want, they can invite it to. Basically, is the people who are very close to the parties. And so that's why we require equal number of observer. And that is, they are closely tied to the parties. So that is the different roles.
So the observers could also be advisors.
Observer does not provide any advisor. Observer only pulling observer for their reaction to the resolution. So they gave their satisfaction, survey. They fill the survey. So they only do that. They are invited by the parties. So they are not neutral.
Andy, can I do a follow up on that? Are they present? Because I'm wondering if there's some, if I invite my uncle to observe, there's a way in which there's a social relationship that's going on, mm-hmm. and I have a responsibility to him, or I have a relationship with him and I know his views, which is why I want him included. Yeah. And so I'm thinking, even if he's not speaking to me during this time, if he's present, there can be an influence on my choices and my behavior. I'm not saying that's a negative thing, especially if they invite them. But are they present? Do they observe the process while it's going on?
Yeah, see here in this screen, observer will have all the access, the knowledge of dispute and the claim of each party. That's the job of mediator, is basically going to make sure observer that invited have full knowledge of dispute and also the claim. And they have access to the mobile device, because they're not physically, everybody is not physically present, are not required. So they basically, for every resolution we send it out, and they just, on their web, they just basically fill in the survey form, that's it.
Okay, so we have a few questions in the chat box. So one is, thanks for the excellent presentation. Is this also part of the AI-driven platform that you previously created for trademark disputes?
That is in my previous to here. Those units are actually was previously introduced in my couple, not last year and the year before, this presentation.
Okay.
And now we just make it. Now I'm more focused on the algorithm part. That means those variables, those weights, and the box. How to create the box so that we can keep the this iteration moving to the right direction, and how do we exit? So we are more doing in the past year, we are doing this kind of work.
Okay. Mike, does that answer your question?
Yeah. Yes, thanks so much for the excellent presentation, Andy. Okay.
I had a question. Where does your the overall AI project stand as far as trademarks is concerned? You were talking about possibly expanding that to consumers at one point. How is that? Could you give us just a short update on that?
We are our tenant. We currently use it quite extensively in the tenant, landlord tenant, and also in the family dispute, and very limited in the contract dispute. For the trademark, we have been working with the China Trademark Association for the past couple of years, but a very small, very little progress because the some organization change and some there are some administrative issues. So we are not moving quick enough in that aspect.
Could I ask just one more follow up question? Yes. How many cases have you been able to use this for, as far as landlord tenant and family disputes?
We used about over 50,000 cases, about 30,000 in the landlord, 15,000 in the family dispute, and a couple of thousand for the contract, and some trivial, I don't know how to category dispute.
Thanks so much, and thanks again for the excellent presentation. Thank you.
Sure.
Well, I think that
thank you very much. Really appreciate
the second question we had in the box, in the chat box, but there's a comment by Dan. Even in the US, the venues in which the mediators is important to the parties. I think this is just them riding on what Leo was talking about, the cultural differences. Where mediators are expected to have an opinion. So how do you find observers at this skill? That's a question for you, Andy.
Observer is basically invited by the parties, by the party in dispute. For example, if I have a dispute with my landlord, I invite my sister to be my observer. And the landlord maybe invite his sister, so his relative. So observer are invited by the parties. So we invite equal number of the observer. There's no any qualification. But they need to be able to access to the mobile device, and also they need to understand the cases, the dispute.
So how do they get access to the mobile devices and the cases?
They have, as long as they have cell phone, that will work.
Okay. So it's all online? All of
Everything is online. Everything is online.
Great. Do we have any other questions? If not, I'll just turn it back over to Leah. Thank you very much, Andy, for the excellent presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Aysen. Thank you, Lee. Leah, thank you, Michael. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Morenike. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Morenike and Andy. What a wonderful and fascinating presentation and contribution for this week. We look forward to seeing everyone for the next number of events. And don't forget the social hour on Friday. It's nice to have a chance to connect with you all.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.